asset allocation strategies for client portfolios. As the primary spokesman for the firm's investment service, Michael develops and disseminates economic and financial market viewpoints. He's also responsible for selecting and overseeing providers of investment services. Michael holds an MBA with highest honors from Harvard Business School and a BA with honors from Princeton. He's also a chartered financial analyst. Please welcome Michael Tyler.
Thank you, good morning, and thanks for coming out so early for what I hope will be a very terrific day for all of you throughout. I have very little time and a lot of slides, so I'm going to give you the express version and also tell you that if you want a copy of the slides, and just let me know or let any of the other Eastern Bank and Eastern Wealth Management people know, and we'll get them to you. So, I can make this work. So, just picking up on where Rob started, the U.S. economy is a profoundly amazing machine, and it is frankly doing better than many people think. You hear everything in the headlines about how bad everything is, but the reality is that we've been growing pretty consistently for several years already. There are reasons that you have to be concerned. Certainly looking at the far right of that chart there, the fall off in the fourth quarter of last year was certainly something to be concerned about. A good chunk of that was because of Hurricane Sandy, and another even bigger chunk was because of a fall off in government spending over that period. So when we hear all the talk about the sequester and about continuing resolutions and everything else, there's reason to be concerned. But having said that, if you really focus on housing and on jobs, you'll see that the U.S. economy is doing better and will continue to. So here's some good news. Leading indicators, a nice index of what is likely to happen in the future, have been positive ever since early 2009 and are continuing to look positive, but they've been slowing down. So there's some concern there that perhaps the economy is running out of gas, and is this the right time for the government to be stepping back? Interesting, worthwhile question. Meanwhile, there's no inflation. That's certainly a good thing. We don't have to worry about prices getting out of hand. And that gives all of the policymakers at the Fed and in Congress and in the states much more latitude in terms of what their policy can be. So I've showed here both the producer prices and consumer prices, and it's a little hard to read the numbers, but zero is a flat line, and as you can see, that it's pretty low. If you go into individual sectors of the economy, likewise, pretty good story. Durable goods, washing machines, cars, and other things, all looking good. Auto sales in particular have really been ramping up over a long period of time. And that makes sense because the U.S. auto fleet today, just all of our cars collectively, is older today than it's ever been in history. People have held on to their cars through a very bad economy. And so now, finally, we're getting to a point where we're seeing that pent-up demand start to turn into new vehicle sales. Meanwhile, manufacturing is doing fine, and consumers, that's retail sales on the bottom right, have been spending money. Increase in the payroll tax, that's Social Security and Medicare, that took place in January, put a little bit of a dent into that, and certainly at the low end, like the Walmart end, if you will, that's had some impact. But at the higher end and across most of the middle class, that hasn't really had an impact yet, and I don't think it will. This is one of the best stories in the economy, the housing market, and it has tremendous ripple effects through the rest of the economy as well. So where do we start? Well, let's start with two things. One, interest rates have been coming down and are at rock bottom levels right now. That translates into really low prices for your mortgage. And so if several years ago you either purchased or refinanced a house at, let's say, 5.5%, 6%, if you're now looking in the newspaper and seeing 3% prices for 30-year mortgages, that's pretty impressive. Meanwhile, the inventory of houses for sale is shrinking. Most, if not all, of the so-called shadow inventory that the banks have held prior to foreclosing is pretty much worked out, certainly in the major metro areas. There are still places that they should never have built in the first place that they'll never work out. But if you leave that aside, in the urban clusters, housing is tight. And for example, on the right-hand chart here, what I'm showing you is the change in the number of homes for sale. And as you can see, the number of homes for sale each year has gone down. There's less out there Typically, they like to see about a six-month supply of homes. It's now down to below 5%, almost 4%. That's a very encouraging sign because, among other things, as people have gotten back to work, you'll find that the number of existing home sales on the left and new home sales on the right have both begun to pick up. Of course, it makes sense that existing homes would pick up first because nobody's going to build new houses until the existing ones have sold. Moreover, prices have begun to pick up, and this is really important. So again, the difference between the red and the blue is just a 10-city versus 20-city index, by the way. There's nothing more meaningful than that. But the flat line is zero, and as you can see, housing prices stopped going down about 4 years ago. They started going up, and or at least the rate of decline stopped going down 4 years ago, and things have been improving ever since. Now we're seeing some real positive action in housing prices. Why is this important? Because if at some point the value of your house gets back to the level you paid for it or the level it was when you refinanced, then that means you can refinance again now. And people are getting to that point. Not totally there yet, it varies by market, but nonetheless, and certainly on the West Coast, by the way, it's been a tremendous increase in pricing. A little less so here, where it wasn't hit as badly in the first place. But as you get back to the level you paid for or refinance, then you can refinance again at much lower interest rates, which means you're going to cut your mortgage payment by 30 or 40%. And that's money in your pocket that gets spent or invested, whether it's in redoing the back deck or putting in a new kitchen or taking a vacation. Whatever it is, it's money that gets recycled into the economy. And that's good. And among other things, it gives developers and builders encouragement to build again. So you're seeing housing starts, new houses being built, beginning to pick up. And look at this, construction jobs fell off a cliff when the housing market fell. And these people spend a lot of money. So when those jobs start coming back, as people start building again, that can be profoundly helpful to the U.S. economy.